Bit of introduction, but I'll keep it short because there's a long anecdote and a short anecdote. Obviously, Helen wrote that song, and for those who know Helen, that song is not autobiographical. We'll have some autobiographical songs later tonight. This one is fiction. The other thing is, we started learning this song maybe January of 2023 as a choir. Jean arranged it, wrote the harmonies. And choir practice was happening at the moment, just about, well, within an hour of when Helen drew her last breath. So we had to sing it here tonight.
Thank you, Anne. So next up, we have Shayna.
So that's a picture of me and Nan, obviously, but that big belly is Evangeline, who's also reading today, so you'll see how big she is now. Yesterday, Mom kind of preempted me by putting some of this stuff in the eulogy, but I'm not changing plans. I'm going to read the same thing anyway. And there's some people that weren't there at the funeral yesterday, so you can hear all about the miraculous birth for the first time. This is chapter 12 from Below the Bridge, a selection from. By rights, you shouldn't be here at all, Helen. Those words were said to me so many times that they began to worry me. By rights. Whose rights? What rights? For the first few times I heard them, I was too young to understand what they were all about. And even as I grew older, I couldn't help wondering if there was some sort of stigma or curse on me, something dramatic like the sort of thing one reads about in Knights of the Round Table, Tales from the Arabian Nights, or to put it a little bit more prosaically, Gothic romances. Gradually, I began to understand. Your mother nearly died, you know, Helen, Aunt Viley told me, with what seemed to be a hint of reproach in her voice. Was it my fault? I shivered. Suppose Mom had died and I had lived. Would they have hated me then, held me responsible? Would Dad have married someone else and put a stepmother over me, to quote the Southside women, whose many frightening tales of vicious females made Cinderella's stepmother look like Lady Bountiful? Your grandmother saved you, my child, after two doctors had given up hope, said Aunt Viley. She was cleaning turnip tops the day she told me, or on one of the days she told me, and her lips seemed to keep time with her hands as she picked up, snipped, and discarded the clay-encrusted roots and yellow leaves. The two doctors were so busy working on your mother that they didn't have time for you. And there you were, blue in the face, until mother picked you up, blew her breath into your mouth. You weren't going to die if she could help it, her first grandchild. She just about forced you to live. Mom went into labor on Monday morning, May 5th, 1930, and by Wednesday I was still refusing to come out and face the world. I still sleep with my knees drawn up, and once, quite recently, this was 1979 when she wrote this, by the way, I had a very vivid dream in which I was covered from head to toe with sticky, translucent fluid, encased in it, really, and if I wanted to, I could give it all kinds of Freudian interpretations. On the Wednesday night, Dr. H put through an agonized phone call to his friend and colleague, Dr. J, and between the two of them, they managed to drag me, a most reluctant traveler, into the world at 4:30 on Thursday morning. I don't know if Nanny was allowed to help the doctors or not. Some of the older physicians, like Dr. Carnell and Dr. McPherson, whose frequent house calls spoiled Southsiders for generations of doctors that were to follow them, had worked practically in partnership with her. But these were younger, brisker men with all sorts of theories and techniques. A trained nurse, perhaps, was in the realm of their experience, but not very likely a midwife. Well, I lived, and whether that fact matters to anyone else or not, it certainly matters to me. Forceps helped to yank me from that dark, warm world that I didn't want to leave. Forceps that left an ugly red mark on my forehead. Faded somewhat, I carry it to this day. My left eye was puffed, swollen, and closed, and the sight in it was permanently impaired. But apart from that, I was all right once Nanny had done her work. I've heard so much since then about the rejoicing that went on after my birth that sometimes it seems that I can remember it all myself. Because of the circumstances of my birth, I was a minor celebrity for a time, and amazing though it seems, to some people I still am. Mrs. Simmons, the marathon ironer, has never forgotten my birthday, and every year since she has remembered me with a gift, a phone call or a card, sometimes all three. Once a card came from California, where she was visiting her oldest daughter who had married an American during the war. When I wonder, as we all do, whether life is worth living or not, I think of how I got here, and I feel strangely grateful.
So now Jim Payne is going to join us.
Bear with me while I just set up here. Oops.
I came in here today. This was set up like it was the Jolly Green Giant was going to be using it. But all right. Thank you for your patience, folks. So, actually, my association with Helen goes back quite a long way. I think, in fact, when I first started playing music around St. John's, she was with the, I'm not sure if it was the Writers Guild at that point, but there were a group of writers who actually hired me to do a gig for them. And I think it was probably the first gig I did really around town that wasn't actually in a pub. So I was pretty impressed by that, really. You know, a bunch of famous Newfoundland writers. It was amazing. But, and over the years then after that, you know, we got together a few times between the Writers Guild and the Longside Club, and, you know, so the membership used to kind of go back and forth, it seemed to me, between those two groups. But we did used to do a bunch of songwriting workshops, and Helen was, as it's been pointed out, very much into music and stuff. We didn't always, you know, we didn't always see eye to eye on types of music. I mean, she was a big country music fan. I wasn't really. but we got through that. And you can hear, I think, too, in her some of her songs, you know, some of the kind of the hints of the Salvation Army melodies and passions that go into that. I was brought up in the Salvation Army myself, so I think maybe we sort of also connected through through some of the you know, the hymns and stuff. But anyway, I was originally going to do two songs, and out of a conversation with Steve yesterday morning, we added this one, which is really one that speaks more directly to her her sense of social justice. And for me, of course, even in a lot of times when she wasn't actually writing overtly about it, her social conscience, you know, informed pretty much everything that she wrote, as far as I'm concerned. But this one, it's self-explanatory, really. It's called On Our Street. We're a high-class band of people in a high-class part of town, and we get along together very well. Our lawns are all clipped neatly, and our weeds are all kept down, and our floors are spick and spotless, you can tell. But when we heard about the crazies that were moving in, we were scared to death, our hearts all skipped a beat. We'd love for them to have a home outside the loony bin, but for God's sake, please don't put them on our street. On our street, on our street. No, for God's sake, please don't put them on our street. You can drop them anywhere in a circle, court, or square, but for God's sake, please don't put them on our street. We work hard for our money, we deserve a decent life, for ourselves and for our children too, of course. We're law-abiding citizens, we don't want any strife. If we have to, we'll remove that crowd by force. We feel for them sincerely, we wish they had a home, but we have to keep our money value sweet. Surely downtown would be better for where they're coming from. We don't see why we should have them on our street. On our street, on our street. We don't see why we should have them on our street. You can drop them anywhere in a circle, court, or square, but for God's sake, please don't put them on our street. One winter many years ago, a young man came along. Just like this gang, he was searching for a bed. He looked at us so strangely, and he sang a scary song about peace and love and rising from the dead. His clothes were torn and shabby, he didn't smell too good, and oh my God, you should have seen his feet. We hope he found some shelter, you know we're never rude, but for God's sake, please don't put him on our street. On our street, on our street. No, for God's sake, please don't put him on our street. You can drop him anywhere in a stable, court, or square, but for Christ's sake, please don't put him on our street. On our street, on our street. No, for God's sake, please don't put them on our street. You can drop them anywhere in a stable court or square, but for God's sake, please don't put them on our street. No, for God's sake, please don't put them on our street. On our streets. This next song, you know, as I'm sure you're all aware, we have countless songs in this province about the place, you know, people. Anybody who writes songs has written at least one song about how much the place means to them. And this song kind of stands out amongst a lot of those songs because while there have been tons of songs written about the resettling of rural communities, you know, back in the 50s and 60s and so on, this one actually is about a neighborhood in St. John's that that disappeared on Helen's beloved South Side. It's called the Place That Disappeared. And hopefully it goes like this. Sometimes at night I dream about a place that is no more, on a gravel road that dips towards the sea. I see again the children playing down by Hickman's store, and one of them is Dot and one is me. When I awake, I twist and turn within my lonely bed as I recall those happy times we shared. Down on the wharf, up on the hill in front of Harvey Shed, on Southside East before it disappeared. It wasn't always sunshine, it wasn't always good, for some of us were poor or sick or strange. But when I look back, I don't see that, although perhaps I should. Now I think of postman's knock at Taylor's Range, and riding down the hills of salt up in Bain Johnston's store, and copying on ice pans when we dared, or skipping rope to ancient chants we don't hear anymore, on Southside East before it disappeared. Beyond the ridge we were that crowd beyond the tracks, though we hardly ever envied them at all. We hired bikes on Springdale Street to shop downtown for Jack's, and went to concerts at the Orange Hall. But we were always happiest when we stayed on our side, drinking Pepsi, eating cheesecakes, getting paired, or clinging to a horse and cart to steal a breathless ride, on Southside East before it disappeared. It wasn't always sunshine, it wasn't always good, though some of us were poor or sick or strange. But when I look back, I don't see that, although perhaps I should. Now I think of postman's knock on Taylor's Range, and sliding down the hills of salt up in Bain Johnston's store, and copying on ice pans when we dared, or skipping rope to ancient chants we don't hear anymore, on Southside East before it disappeared. And now we're scattered all around Mount Pearl and St. John's. Our road is paved, but no one lives there now. But some of us still brave the path that leads to Soldier's Pond, to boil the kettle up on the hill's green brow. And when we meet on Water Street or at the village mall, the past flies and we're back where we were reared. It's like Good Friday used to be at Old St. Mary's Hall, on Southside East before it disappeared. It wasn't always sunshine, it wasn't always good, though some of us were poor or sick or strange. But when I look back, I don't see that, although perhaps I should. Now I think of postman's knock at Taylor's Range, and sliding down the hills of salt up in Bain Johnston's store, and copying on ice pans when we dared, or skipping rope to ancient chants we don't hear anymore, on Southside East before it disappeared. On Southside East before it disappeared.
And finally, this song is just kind of comes out of a bunch of the songwriting workshops we did. Some of them we did at the old Extension Services building on Bond Street. I guess it was the former Bishop Spencer School. And there might be some people here tonight who were involved with some of those workshops. We did some of them down at Spencer School. But then what we also used to do them in Mount Pearl at 10 Penmore Drive, where Helen lived for the longest time. And she wrote this song called 10 Penmore Drive, based on an old country song by Lacey J. Dalton called 16th Avenue. But it really, it really captured the spirit of people getting together to write songs, being extremely supportive of one another, just kind of throwing out lines here and there. It was a great time, really. And so I was really, happy to be part of it. And it's a lot of cherished memories there as well. So this is 10 Penmore Drive. From the corners of the city, paradise to College Square, some come with expectations, others come with fear. But the melody that's in their hearts is keeping us alive. God bless the crowd that sings so loud at 10 Penmore Drive. With a $1 million spirit, an accordion or guitar, they plan all day to sing and play and perhaps become a star. Some scribble songs in secret on the job from 9 to 5, then drive a while the 6 short miles to 10 Penmore Drive. Now some work for the government, others toil away at home. One of them runs a nursery school, another has to roam. But the songs bring them together, they work only to survive. At night they go to their studio at 10 Penmore Drive. But then one night in a shabby room where old orange curtains hung, like a miracle, some golden words roll off of someone's tongue. After years of being nothing, they're sure they'll soon arrive. And for a while, they go in style to 10 Penmore Drive. Now it looks so uneventful, so quiet and discreet, but so many hopes and dreams and fears are tied up on that street. For they've all composed a song or two, or three, or four, or five. They drive back and forth to prove their worth at 10 Penmore Drive. From the corners of the city, paradise to College Square, some come with expectations, others come with fear. But the melody that's in their heart is keeping them alive. God bless the crowd that sings so loud at 10 Penmore Drive. God bless the crowd that sings so loud at 10 Penmore Drive. God bless the crowd that sings so loud at 10 Penmore Drive.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim. 10 Penmore Drive. Spent a lot of nights on 10 Penmore Drive. Some memories are pretty vivid, and other ones are a little bit foggy. I'll tell you a story. Steve said, I'm going to paint the room. I said, sure, let's paint the room. It was that, you know, that contractor beige downstairs. So we went and we got some paint and we painted the room and we painted it orange. And as Kevin Blackmore would say, orange. It was beyond orange. Anyway, I can picture now Mr. and Mrs. Porter. They came down the stairs and they opened up the door. And Mrs. Porter looked in and said, my, Stephen, it's some bright. And Mr. Porter, you know, with his dry humor, he says, are you still going to be able to sleep here? Anyway, what a laugh. So next we're going to have Lorraine Michael come up, and she's going to talk about social activism and Mrs. Porter.
Okay. I think I can see all of you, so that means you can see me, right? I don't know what I'm going to talk about, so I'm surprised you could tell me. This has been a challenge, actually. I'm very honored to be here tonight and to speak. You know, by the time I met Helen in the early 80s, she was a real icon in my books and an inspiration. And I can't help but thinking, as I thought about her all this week, that if she were here right now and heard me say that, she'd say, don't be so foolish. And what's all the fuss about, right? Because Helen Fogwell Porter, she was the most genuinely self-effacing person I think I've ever met. She had such a deep analysis, such a deep love of social justice, a brilliance in writing, in music, in every way. And yet, she knew who she was. She knew what she had. But it was there so naturally. Helen was doing what came naturally. It wasn't something that was worked out in her head ahead of time. It wasn't something that she had to debate in university classes, though she certainly would be able and probably did do it. But it was inside of Helen. It was what she knew. It was what she lived. It was what she observed. And, you know, Steve wanted me to be funny tonight, and I can't do it, Steve. I'm sorry. others can do it. But for me, Helen brought out the best in all of us, I think. And that's what we're seeing here tonight. I think she certainly brought it out in me. The realization that we're all here together and we're all the same. And be ready to live and love and laugh together. One of the things Helen could do was laugh. She would laugh at so many things, and it was a wry humor that she had. That's how I found it, because you'd be in a very serious conversation, and something would strike her as funny, and she would take the serious and turn it into a little bit of humor. And I thought one way of getting at that, I couldn't think of any examples, you know, because that was all happening so naturally with Helen, that natural wry humor that she had. But one of the poems in Full Circle, I thought, there must be something in there that can speak to that wry humor. And I found one. Now it's going to be hard to read it with those lights coming down on me. I didn't expect that. Hang on. If I turn this way, maybe. Yes, I think I can do it if I do this. It's called A Cure for Pessimism. My Uncle Irving, a somber man most of his life, became almost cheerful when told he had a fatal disease. It was so rough, it was as though he realized that all the ghastly things he had been dreading for years wouldn't happen now because there wouldn't be time. Only Helen could take that and do that wry humor. And that's what I loved about her, one of the things that I loved about her. I want to talk about Full Circle. I was at the book launch, I think a lot of us in the room probably were, and I couldn't put it down when I went home, because in this book, Helen presents, for me anyway, everything that she had lived and observed over all her years. And it was the poor, and it was the sick, and it was the strange, as it was in the song that Jim sang, that inspired so much of this poetry. And if you haven't gotten this, I can't imagine anybody in this room doesn't have it, but if you haven't, get it. And if you have it, go to the back cover. You can hardly read it, by the way. We should have thought about white and gray for people who have visual problems, but go to the back cover, because here's what it says, and we tried to determine who wrote this. It had to be the editor, I think. It's not signed. But on the back cover at Full Circle, it says, "Balanced on the sharpest edge of life, yet caught in the ruthless pull of aging and death, these poems offer keen insights into the way the world was and the way it ought to be, and reminds us that the fight for a good life and a just society is never over." Excuse me, the book fell down. That, to me, sums up the book, and it sums up everything that Helen believed and everything that Helen was. The insight she has that it's never over, that we keep going in a circle. Circles keep closing. We keep coming back, and it is never over. But she would smile all the way through it and keep going. And that's the Helen's message to us. And that's what I wanted to do tonight when I thought about it. I thought, I don't want to talk about Helen. I want Helen to speak to us. And I think in Full Circle, she does that in a very, very particular way that continues to touch me. And if you come into my house and you go to a washroom in the house when you're visiting, this is on the toilet, by the way, for you to read. So Helen is there all the time. Doing what comes naturally, as I said, for Helen, there was no questioning, you know, about the things that she observed. There was no questioning about the struggle for justice. There was no questioning about making life right for women. And for me, as a woman, that was the thing that struck me so much and still does. When you read the book of poems in particular, you really get that. Helen's understanding of all the different ways in which women have suffered and continue to suffer, and her desire to do whatever could be done to help that. That was why in 2003, I was very pleased when the New Democratic Party, for whom Helen had run four times, when it created a fund called the Helen Fogwell Porter Fund. And the reason for that fund was to raise money so that women candidates could have money given to them that they would determine how to use. They may want to use it for childcare. They may want to use it for an outfit to, you know, for campaigning. But and to this day, there are no restrictions on, because Helen wouldn't have wanted restrictions. It was for the women who received the money, who were going to run, to use as they saw they needed, as they saw fit. And it was funny. This is one little funny story, Steve. I had some people call me up and say, "Lorraine, is Helen dead?" I said, "What are you talking about? Helen Porter." "Yes, is she dead?" I said, "No, she's not dead." "Well, they've named, what's this fund about?" So when I told Helen, she roared laughing, right? So she said, "I'm glad I didn't have to die to make something happen." So, right? So you didn't have to, Helen. You certainly didn't have to. So I was really actually quite pleased with the fact that the party didn't wait until Helen was dead to do that. And so, you know, Helen's spirit here tonight is life has to become better for women. And it's not only for women we know, but if we make life better for women, if the structures change to help women, Helen would say, then it's going to be better for everybody. And that's what she knew, and that's what her experience told us. So Helen, thanks for all the laughs, thanks for the love, thanks for the songs, and thanks to all of you for being here tonight. We love Helen, all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Lorraine. So next up, we have a poem reading from Evangeline.
Hello. Today, I will be reading Orange Papers. They come in wooden boxes, loosely wrapped oranges, absorbing their sweet smell. Thin and delicate, they survived a long sea voyage to reach my open hands. I like to touch them, flatten them with my fingers, smooth them out one by one, and store them in the sideboard to sniff and handle on all the days when they're when there be no oranges.
Yes, sounds like Mrs. Porter. So next up, we have Jenny Gere and Sandy Morse. They'll take a second to get set up.
It is truly an honor to have been asked to sing this evening. This is a song that that Helen wrote for her husband and their love together, and it's called The Scent of Lilacs. The scent of lilacs, sweet perfume lilacs, followed us the day when we walked down the aisle. Well, the smell of lilacs, pure purple lilacs, I see again your dark-eyed wedding smile. And you were true to me, I have no doubt about it. Your love so strong, I thought I could never live without it. Then came that cruel day, you were taken away with the scent of lilacs wafting through the air. The scent of lilacs, sweet perfume lilacs, brings back to me loving memories of you, dear. And the look of lilacs, deep purple lilacs, reminds me of your promise to be true. Stone so hard and cold, it lies beneath that tree, dear. Robbed the warmth of you and left me lost and nowhere. When I walk this way, don't seem far away with the scent of lilacs lingering in. I sit here all alone. The tree that's blooming where you are sleeping, there's blossoms like the ones that are long gone. That stone so hard and cold, it lies beneath the tree, dear. Robbed the warmth of you, it left me lost and nowhere. But when I walk this way, you don't seem far away with the scent of lilacs lingering in the air. With the scent of lilacs lingering in the air.
It's the most romantic song. If the family doesn't mind, I'm going to continue to sing that song because I think it touches me. It's just so romantic and beautiful. And what a gift. Oh. Molly Kennedy. Thank you. Well, I listened to Molly's recording of that song, and I had never heard of Molly Kennedy, but I'd love to hear other recordings if you have them, or I'll try to find. Okay. Rhyme and Country. And she was a good friend of your mother's. Yes, yeah, absolutely beautiful voice. I will continue to sing that song. And this is a Leonard Cohen song. And I know Helen very much enjoyed Leonard Cohen. And I heard her on Crosstalk one day. Oh, yes. She, I think Vicky was on, Vicky Hines, and she called in and she said, "Now, I don't think you should let anyone else sing Alexandra Leaving but Jenny Geer, Vicky. This is my advice. I don't think you should let anyone else sing it." So I'm going to sing it now for her. Suddenly the night, it has grown colder. The God of love preparing to depart. Alexander hoisted on his shoulders. They slipped between the sentries of the heart, upheld by the simplicities of pleasure. And they gained the light, they formlessly entwined, and radiant beyond your widest measure. The voices and the wine, but it's not a trick, your senses all deceiving. A fitful dream, morning will exhaust, and to say goodbye to Alexandra Leaving. Say goodbye to Alexandra Lost. 'Cause even though she sleeps upon your satins, and even though she would wake you with her kiss, to do not say the moment was imagined. And do not stoop to strategies like this. Somewhat long prepare for this to happen. Go firmly to the window, just drink it in. This exquisite music, this Alexandra's laughing. Your first commitment is tangible again. You who had the honor of her evening, and by that honor you had your own restored, to say goodbye to Alexandra Lee. Alexandra's leaving with her lord, even though she sleeps upon your satin, even though she wakes you with her kiss. Do not say the moment was imagined, and do not stoop to strategy like this. Someone long prepared with the occasion, in full command of every plan that you wrecked. Just do not choose the coward's explanation, 'cause that hide behind cause and the effect. You who were bewildered by her meaning, whose code was broken and crucifix uncrossed, just saying goodbye to Alexandra leaving, and saying goodbye to Alexandra lost, just saying goodbye to Alexandra leaving, and say goodbye to Alexandra lost.
Thank you. Thank you for this.
Thank you, Jenny and Sandy. So next, Bernice Morgan, to talk about Mrs. Porter's writing life.
Yes, I see what we mean by the lights. Yes. If you can't hear me, I'd like you to shout. First of all, I want to thank Helen's family for arranging these. You know, Anne and Kathy and Stephen and your children and grandchildren. It's just been an amazing series of events. And Helen, of course, richly deserves it. And it's wonderful to see her words read by so many people, and to hear people talk about her. She was the most amazing person I ever met. We met, Helen and I, back in 1962, I think. We were both, Helen and I and Jerry Ruba, in our late 20s or early 30s, and we had gone to an extension course at Memorial, a night course in writing. And I'd never met, there was no one in the room I knew, not a soul. And the teacher asked us to write something and pass it in right away, which was a horror to me. Because, well, I shouldn't, yes. Anyway, Helen wrote and read what she had written. He asked her to. Obviously, she had passed in the best thing. And it was about housework. And it was the first time I'd laid eyes on her, and she stood up and read this essay about housework. Very political subject. And I was just blown away. Anyway, she and Jerry and I went to the course. Dr. Alders was the name of the man who was teaching the course. And it was a night course, and the three of us became fast friends. We all had young children at the time, and we all had full-time jobs, and I don't know how we did it, but we managed until we were in our 80s. We got together every few weeks, and we celebrated every birthday together. We drove hundreds of miles together, and ate countless restaurant meals. We had just a wonderful time. We had very diverse opinions and lots of opinions. Three of us were opinionated, not Jerry so much, but Helen and I. Yes, Jerry said one time we should be, this was after Helen lost her sight. She said, look at us, the blind, the crippled, and the mad. Helen was a marvelous writer. She had a mind that was just extraordinary. And I did take a course from her later because she started teaching night courses at the Extension. And I took a course from her. She could look at a piece of writing and she could analyze it. Not only was she good at grammar and spelling was my downfall, but she also knew all the subtleties. Like she would say, oh, that person would never say that. She knew. And when she put something into a piece of writing, like a detail, like if you read, January, February, you will see all the little subtle things that family had going for them, all the neighbors, and what was there, the cat that wanted to live on top of the fridge, you know, all these things. One of the reviewers said that if an anthropologist is looking at how working class people lived in St. John's in that time, they only have to read January, February. It was things that, and it was never put in like icing on a cake. It was woven into the story. It reflected that the things weren't just there to create an effect. They reflected the character and the place and the time. I don't know if anyone ever achieved that kind of thing about St. John's, middle class, working class St. John's. No one ever has. She's just a marvelous writer. She was wonderful to work with. The three of us, Helen, Jerry, and I, a little while after we met, someone whose name I will not say, put out an anthology of Newfoundland writing, and there wasn't one woman in it, not one. And so Helen and Jerry and I decided we would put out an anthology of women, and we did. It was called From the Place. It was all women's writing. And Helen was much more, she was a professional writer before she went to that class, because she was doing reviews for any number of magazines, McCall's, Chatelaine, one that was published in Nova Scotia, and small literary magazines, book reviews and commentaries. And, you know, so she was much more professional. She has said that she, in another life, she would like to have been a journalist. And she had that inquiring mind. She went right into the seed of the thing. She didn't mess around. She just knew what was there and what was needed. I don't know of anyone else who was like her. She was, you know, as Lorena said, she was so unique. She was a person who could sit down with anyone. She could sit down with the guy who was bumming outside the supermarket or the Dalai Lama and sit down and have a conversation, and she'd know where he came from and who his relatives were. And it's thought now to be rude to ask someone where they came from, but it was almost the first question Helen would ask. And then she would say, oh, the Morgans, oh, there must be the Morgans over around Bay Roberts. And do you know this man? Or do you know this woman? So she had your family tracked before you were there for 5 minutes. And this was true of everyone. And she had no distinction of class. She approached everyone with the same kind of open heart that she was so interested, you know? She was an amazing person. She gave so much to everyone. And we all of us think of ourselves, or most of us do, as Christians or socialists or giving people. We write a few checks every year sometimes, you know, but Helen did all of that often checks she couldn't have afforded. But she went beyond that. It was a personal thing. She went to the person. When she was in an old people's home, she was always trying to organize the staff to get a union. I say, Helen, you're going to be the... you're going to be the first person kicked out of an old people's home for interrupting riot. You know, she always wanted to do that, to go and do. I remember one time we were talking about some politician that we both loathe, and she said, you know, I really don't think I ever want to meet him, because I think I do. If I did, I'm afraid I might like him. You know, because she found something in everyone to like. And, you know, she knew, she read everything. She was probably had the equivalent of a PhD in Canadian literature. She knew everyone in Canada. You can go anywhere in Canada and people know Helen Porter, writers do. A couple of years ago, I sat down, I was sitting next to Margaret Atwood. Only thing Margaret Atwood knew about me was that I was from Newfoundland. And she said, do you know Helen Porter? And I said, yes, and how is she? And I told her that Helen had lost her sight. And a few weeks later, Helen got some tapes from her, from her, Margaret Atwood, which raised my opinion of Margaret Atwood greatly. But everyone knew Helen. She carried on correspondence with people like Alice Munro and Margaret Lawrence. She didn't have any distinctions. She made no distinction. And she knew she was very sure of herself in a way that was not aggressive or proud. She just knew. She went to the heart of things. She read any number of newspapers. Even after she lost her sight, she knew what was happening in the world. You'd go in and she'd say, what do you think of this or that? And this was something hadn't heard of yet, that she had already heard of. She was absolutely passionate about public libraries and public medicine and public radio. And she believed that these things were part of what we should have, you know. And this generosity that she had, it was not at a distance. I've told some of you this story before. I went out, when she was living on Franklin Avenue, I went out one time to return a book, I think, something in my hand. We were always exchanging books. And sitting on the steps, there were two young people, a young man and a young woman, surrounded by garbage bags. And they said, oh, Helen's not in, but we will hold your book for her. We're waiting till she comes back because we do her laundry in her house. You know, this is the kind of private thing that Helen would never even thought of mentioning to you, that she did things like that. That was aside from worrying about world affairs, writing letters to the editor, running for the NDP, and going to countless meetings for which she was never paid. She let these private, personal things, you know. I thought of her more as a sister than a friend, and I miss her very, very much. I have one quote here, and I wrote it down because I wanted to get it right, and I hope I can read it. She said, she was talking about herself. I asked her, it was an interview I did with her, I think. She said, some people see colors and some people don't. I see every bit of suffering. It's not a nice way to be. I don't enjoy it, but I do. And I can't ignore it. And that was Helen. She lived the life that she had visioned. She never set aside from that. She stayed on it, helping people and being true to herself. And that is to live. And she did have a wonderful life. And I admired her and loved her. Thank you.
Thank you, Bernice. Just one sec. I'm missing the sound.
Tobacco spit on my new Sunday hat, where I took such pains to picking a handsome yellow cat. Now, Mr. Bruce, there's no use talking. You and I shall have to part. For if I'd known you chawed the weed, you'd have never got my heart. You're spitting around the house from morning until night. I'm sure the furniture will soon be in an awful plight. Such awful creatures as men are. I wonder what's the use for them to chew tobacco and spit out all the juice. They spit in every corner, they spit in every room, they spit beneath the table, they spit behind the broom, they spit on Bristol's carpet, they spit on wooden floor, they spit painted floor, they spit in the house and out of door. The other day I took a ride clear up to St. Johnstown, and I wore my very best of brand new purple gown. But when I took my place among those plaguey cars, I almost dropped my market bag and burst right into tears. For every single seat where I undertook to sit was nothing but a notion of tobacco spit. And then just to hear the creatures talk about women drinking tea, and making mountains out of hills and a whale out of a flea. They talk, too, about the schoolgirls, about their chewing gum. And with mouthfuls of tobacco, they say, thy kingdom come. And if they think that life is worth for nothing but to chaw, well, they can't expect the women folks to do nothing but chaw. But I will assert my rights as a female, not a goose. If you wants to chaw the Becky, you shall swallow all the juice.
Sorry for the technical difficulty there. I just got a page ahead here. So next is the sing-along, You Are My Sunshine.
Yep. They also have lyrics to it or something like that?
Yeah, the lyrics will come up on the screen.
Oh, I see.
Yep.
With a little bouncy ball.
Sorry.
Come on, everybody.
Thank you, Jim. All right, thanks to everybody who came out to help us celebrate Mrs. Porter's life, and quite a life it was. Now there are a couple of messages that will be read. We're going to start with Anne is going to read a message from Robert Koch.
Am I on now? Yes.
Okay, good.
From a friend, Robert Koch. My association with Helen primarily starts with one of her plays, A Quiet Evening at Home. Oops, it's about us. I was a middle school teacher of English based in Western Newfoundland. The play was an optional component of the program, but I used it every September for 20 years. So this is and was my start. The play was a fictional account of a family from the point of view of a mother promoting strong political and community values and raising a family. From an immediate real-time perspective, it is difficult to relay numerous example situations of young students completely engrossed in this material. In fact, I often use the play twice in September. However, one example of grade eights having a positive experience was when I used the play for a Christmas concert program at the local high school. In this instance, the students had to compete for the roles of mother, father, girls, boys, the telephone ringer, the foot stomper, and the vacuum cleaner. The foot stomper, for example, would have to aggressively pound the floor with their boots. The vacuum person would have to simulate the sound of a vacuum for well over a minute. A tall 13-year-old boy just wanted to be the vacuum cleaner sound, and he got the part. We dressed him in a cardboard furniture box with a hole for his face and vacuum cleaner written across the front of the box. At the edge of the stage, he performed for over a minute. Of course, this is while the lead character, Louise, was speaking. After his performance, he was pleased that he would be recognized and appreciated amongst his peers and community that holiday season. I did not see him at school the next year. I learned he went to St. John's for cancer treatment. Just didn't know this for the story, he returned home in May. My intention was to give the students a happy beginning to the school year. For many students, for 1 hour a day, they got to be the Fogwell Porter family. Personally, I was pleased and thankful for those Septembers. A couple of years ago, Mr. Steve Porter gave me a photograph, and in the image was retired General Romeo Dallaire. At the time, he was touring Canada. In this photograph also were Mr. Steve Porter and his mother, Mrs. Helen Fogwell Porter. Special, that photograph, expressions of respect and kindness, looking more closely, I think, heroes. To me, Helen Fogwell Porter, you were a hero. Thank you for the contribution to my life, from Robert Koch.
Thank you, Robert. Next, a message from Julie, read by Kathy.
Yes, so my daughter, Julia, is up there with Manny, was supposed to be here, but she took sick in Shetland, got pneumonia just before this was about to happen and couldn't make it. She and her partner and mom's great-granddaughter were supposed to be here. So Julia sent this message, and I probably won't get through it without crying a bit. And by the way, just Robert's going to tell you about this, but as soon as we finish the messages, anybody else who wants to say anything at all, we'll have a chance, and you can just let us know, put up your hand or whatever, we'll come to you with the mic. And being a former broadcaster who always had to, you know, end a show right on time, the more succinct you can be, but you know, as much depth as you want. But yeah, so we can put in as many people who would like to have something to say. But this is what Julia had to say. I'm heartbroken that Tove and I cannot be there today to celebrate the life of my wonderful Nana Banana. My Nan was one of the most important people in my life. Apart from doing all the lovely Nan-related activities, such as baking cookies together and playing Chinese checkers, we spoke about feminism, compassion for the poor, and religion. I would often call my Nan after school and took comfort in her long stories and commentary on various topics. I had regular sleepovers with my Nan until I moved to the UK and look back on those times fondly. I remember the background noise of Nan constantly on the phone and the constant hum of CBC radio, and very regularly her on the radio calling into various radio programs with a strong opinion about whatever topic was being discussed. She would always make me mac and cheese and would have a chocolate bar hidden for me somewhere in the kitchen. I remember our bedtime stories, which changed to listening to audiobooks with her as she lost her sight and I got older. I am so grateful she got to meet my daughter Tove, her youngest great-granddaughter, in her later life. And although she couldn't see her or remember her name, she would speak about her as if she was some kind of super baby human. I loved her deeply, admired her. She made me proud to be a woman. I miss you, Nana Banana. Love, Julia Guglia.
Thank you, Kathy. Next, Maxine sent a message and is going to be read by Brenda.
And I'm going to sit down. This is from Maxine Pike, her longtime friend in school together in the same class. My friendship with Helen didn't begin in our class, so the years we spent at Prince of Wales College. But when she and Kathy came to Boston on business with CBC, Helen called me to say hello from their hotel, and I invited her to cancel their reservations and spend the remaining time with Ted, my husband, and me in our home in Beverly Farms. It was a fun time, and our friendship was born. Whenever I went home, I always called on Helen, and she would arrange a luncheon for me to get to see our class friends. This ritual was always a highlight for me, and Helen was the one who made it happen. I followed her. Sorry about that. I followed her. Oh, gosh. It's on my phone, not written down. I followed her. I got to get that one down. I followed her career. Sorry about that. I know, she'd be laughing. I followed her career as she climbed the ladder of success in her world of writing. And advocating for the underprivileged, we would have long conversations on the phone, she filling me in on all the local happenings. In all this time, I never ever heard her complain about the many challenges she faced. Not one time did she ever have a pity party, and I admired her and loved her for that. What a wonderful memory to embrace an incredible woman. I truly do miss my special talented friend. My life is empty without her. I will be there with you all in spirit. Sincerely, blessings to all, Maxine Pike Pitcher.
And here's one from Tammy, read by Steve.
This is from my stepdaughter, Tammy Hewlett, who can't travel here from Willis, Texas for medical reasons, but my other two girls came. One, Laura, came from Edinburgh, Scotland, and Nikki came from Calgary, Alberta. So I'm glad that you made it. And Tammy certainly sends her regrets, but she did send this message. Some family trees are like Tuckamore, tangly and twisted. Because of its environment, strong and resilient and definitely full of character. I was 11 when I first met my new granny Helen on Penmore Drive. Trailing in and out of the house and forever tied with my memory of her is the scent of wild roses from the bushes in the yard. She introduced me to parsnips, which I thought were really weird St. John's carrots. Real butter, so delicious it spoiled me for life. And most importantly, she was the first person I ever met who loved books as much as I did. Granny Helen had a way of making you feel accepted without a fuss, like you naturally belonged. And she was always intensely interested in what you had to say. She made my kids, her great-grandkids, more branches on that twisty tuckamore, feel the same way. They were always astounded by her great memory and her chocolate chip cookies. Long may her memory and her legacy live. Love, Tammy and Richard Hewlett, Spencer, Zachary, and Joy.
Okay, so if anyone has a story to share or anything like that, Steve has the
We do have a couple of people, Robert. Well, thank you very much, Robert, for
you're welcome
for doing this. He took this on, and the commitment and the dedication that he's shown us and the delivery, we really, really totally appreciate it. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you. My pleasure.
First, I'm going to call on Lynn Fogwell. To talk about more of that tangly tuckamore of the family tree.
Okay. So, I'm going to apologize. You see, in June, when Steve and I were emailing each other, he asked me if I would say a few words, and I thought he meant a Fogwell few words. So now I'm not going to read all of that, but I'll just sort of highlight some of the family stories that Helen particularly loved. There used to be 25 Fogwell first cousins. I'm one of the youngest. Helen was one of the oldest. And with Helen's passing, now there's only 6 of us left. So you can imagine the sort of sadness that creates. But as first cousins, we were just a noisy, talkative, nosy group of people. And we loved each other, and we got together a lot. And in the last sort of couple of decades, it was often when I came home to visit. And I recall this one time we were having lunch. We usually got together for lunch. And we were at the old Battery Motel that time. And there was about 30 of us. And as usual, we were talking and laughing. And everybody was holding multiple conversations simultaneously. And we were very, very loud. And we were in the middle of a heated argument about something to do with our grandfather. And I remember the waitress coming by, filling up the coffee cups. And I whispered to her and I said, "Are we disturbing the other guests in the dining room?" And she said, "Oh no, my dear, you're just entertaining the entire room." We were very talkative. Marg's brother-in-law, Marg's husband, Ray Fallon, was very fond of saying that when you married a Fogwell woman, when you walked down the aisle to the altar and said, "I do," were the last words you got into a conversation. Several of our cousins, Helen, Sylvia, and Don, and others, decided we should have a Fogwell family reunion, and it took a lot of work and effort. And it happened in 1995. There was about 150 of us came. So besides the 25 first cousins, we had 15 second cousins. They were the Millertown Fogwells, and we were the St. John's Fogwells, right? And so it was wonderful. I mean, there was several events. We went whale watching and all that kind of stuff. But the big event was at Bowring Park, which is always special to the Fogwell family. And so there was a dinner. And of course, there was music. There were speeches. There was a lot of few words being said. And there was poetry. And speaking of poetry, Lorraine, I wanted to thank you for reading out the poem about our Uncle Irving, because it was, like, as you said, it captured that sort of wicked sense of humor in the poem. But she also very succinctly captured his character. And that poem appeared on, you know, the Ride the Poetry buses? And so you probably don't know, but those Ride the Poetry buses, and that one in particular, was on the buses in Edmonton, where I live. And when the time was finished for them to come down and others to go up, the Edmonton Transit Authority gave me several, and I sent one back to Helen, so she had the one from Edmonton, and I still have one on the wall in my home. I wanted to talk a little bit about her activism, her social activity, and I think there's a Fogwell gene, to tell you the truth. But she was very proud of our grandfather, Will Fogwell, and he was one of the charter members of the REWA, the Railway Employees Welfare Association, when it was founded in 1927. And I had actually found for her a photograph of the board of directors in, I think it was 1931, and Will was in it. But some of you, probably many of you know, I mean, it was amazing what they did. There was a death benefit fund, a widow's pension fund, a sick benefit fund, an education fund for the orphaned children. But probably the greatest thing they did were those REW houses on Avalon Terrace on Old Topsail Road and also on Craig Miller Avenue. And there was Fogwell's living in three of those houses, right? Sort of our grandparents lived there, and my father then lived with his widowed mother. And Helen and Uncle Bob and her family lived in one of them. And Uncle Irving, the one who was happy when he found out he was dying. Uncle Irving and his wife and his family lived in one of them. And I just thought it was just Fogwellland. But anyway, that legacy of union activism, of commitment to social justice, I think it was born in her from the moment she apparently almost didn't make it, but entered this world. You know that she was deeply fond of both Holloway School and Prince of Wales. I don't remember ever seeing her without her PWC ring on her finger. And I meant to bring mine with me. I realized after I got on the plane that I'd left it at home. But anyway, but she loved Prince of Wales. But a story, when she was very young and ready to start at Holloway School, she would drive with my dad. My dad was 16 when Helen was born. So she would drive with my dad. He would drive his father, our grandfather Will, to work. Will bought a car. He never did learn how to drive, but he bought a car. So my dad would drive his father to work at the railway station. Then he would drop off Helen at Holloway School, and he'd go to work at George Neal Limited in Beck's Cove. When school got out, Helen would walk from Holloway to Beck's Cove, climb into the back seat of the car and read her book. So her love of reading started really, really early. And my dad is the one who told me my favorite Helen story about her love of reading. She loved to read while she walked. She walked down the street reading a book, and one day she actually walked into a pole because she was so engrossed in the story that she was reading at the time. So what else can I say? There was a couple of the stories. So when we had that Fogwell family reunion, that really Helen and Sylvia really pushed me to really get into researching the Fogwell family history. And so I've been at it 28 years now and still at it. But some of the stories that she loved the most were she was delighted to find out that we had an Argentinian branch. And there were 50 Spanish-speaking Argentinian Fogwells. And one of them, Rodolfo Fogwell, is a very well-known author. So again, I think that writing gene is there somewhere in the Fogwell line. But that was because, and we were related, it's a direct part of our family, because our great-grandfather Samuel came from Devon to Newfoundland in 1858, but his older brother stayed in Devon, and it was his grandson, whom he named Samuel, and he went to Argentina, to Buenos Aires in 1900, to work for a very large landowner, and he trained polo ponies for the Prince of Wales. But anyway, all these 50 Fogwell Spanish-speaking descendants in Argentina are our Fogwells. So that was a real thrill to her. But the last little piece I'll tell you, I can probably do this without even looking at it. The ancestor of ours that she was most fascinated by was our whatever great-great-great-great grandmother Joan Fogwell. So Joan was born in 1730 in Barry Pomeroy, and when she was 18 in 1748, she gave birth to an illegitimate daughter, whom she named Gertrude for her mother. 6.5 years later, she gave birth to another illegitimate child, a son she named Joseph. 5 years after that, in 1760, she gave birth to yet another illegitimate child, a son she named William. And William is our ancestor, which begs the question,
Are we Fogwolves? Since we don't know the father of her children, we don't know what our surname is. We don't even know if it was one father of the three children or was it three fathers of three children. But she found that really interesting. So she went on to surprise us in 1770 when she was 40. She got married. She married a man named Simon Brewer, who was a twice-widowed man from the village of Barry Pomeroy. And big surprise, 16 months after they got married, when she was 40, she gave birth to a child, her first child, in wedlock. And he was named Edward Brewer. So Joan lived to the ripe old age of 68 at a time when life expectancy in England was 37. So she was, Helen just thought she was an amazing woman. She was clearly a bit of a rebel. She marched to her own drum. She was, a very devoted single mother who raised her children well. Because Joan's son, William, our ancestor, named one of his sons, Edward Brewer Fogwell. And his son, John, named one of his sons, Edward Brewer Fogwell. So it speaks to that tie and that the family clearly was kept together. And so Helen thought that this really did speak to a deep bond within the family, which Joan created. And so I think that in many ways, not all of them, but in many ways, Joan and Helen, seven generations apart, were very similar to each other because they each defined and they walked their own path. They each lived to a ripe old age and had, think about Joan, we don't know, but think they have pretty wonderful lives. We know that about Helen. They were extraordinary women and they were wonderful mothers who created deep and lasting bonds within their families, both nuclear and extended. And as I say, Helen was she was like somewhere between an aunt and a sister. She used to babysit me when I was born so that her parents and my parents could play bridge together on Friday night. So those are some of the Fogwell family stories. And one NDP story, in the federal election of 1979, Helen was running in Mount Pearl, and I was running in Edmonton East. And our cousin Sylvia was working at CBC. And so on election night, Sylvia arranged to do on-air interviews with Helen and with me. So, and I think that I'm sure I was the only non-Newfoundland riding that got that kind of coverage. And it was way better coverage than I got in Conservative Alberta, believe me. But to me, everything that she was, it came from that sort of wonderful family that we grew up in. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Lynn. Next, I'm going to call on Regina Best. She wants to read Full Circle.
Some logistics here. The bar is going to do last call in about 5 minutes. So if anybody wants to get a drink or anything, then there you go.
Hi, everyone. Is this on?
Yes. One thing I have to say is that I won't look at lilacs the same way. I'll always remember this night. I think that was beautiful. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Regina Best. I was the coordinator for the Arts and Letters for 25 years. I'm since retired, happily. And I first met Helen in 1991 when she called the office. Of course, Betty Dunphy had retired, and Helen called the office because she had to find out who is this new one taking over the Arts and Letters. So it was all of the questions from where are you from, who knit you, and whatever. One of the funny things that I remember about how we did become really good friends and we had great conversations about a number of different things. She's the only person that used to leave me a message and it used to actually fill up my voicemail. So, and as some of you know, I helped coordinate an evening at the A.C. Hunter Library a few years ago, and it was a great turnout, and it was a lovely turnout because Helen was there. So at that time, I read through a lot of her work to, you know, kind of coordinate that night. And one of the pieces of writing that I read belonged to Helen was the poem called Full Circle. And it was just something that really stuck with me. I don't know why, but it really stuck with me. And, you know, I mean, it was a poem about child abuse. And it was struck from a 1979 high school anthology by a provincial Department of Education bureaucrat. So there was a lot of subjects that were taboo and not talked about back in the 70s and the early 80s. But this one, I don't know, it meant something. It was one that I just really remembered. It was called Full Circle. When Joan was 2, her mother pushed her down the cellar stairs. When Joan was 4, her father left, as he planned to for years. When Joan was 5, she went to school. The teacher said, "My, my, your work is very poor, Joan, but you'll really have to try. Oh, Joan, you're such a dirty child. Your blouse is soiled and torn. Your nails are black. Your nose, oh dear," and she turned away in scorn. When Joan was 8, the children laughed and called her Stinky Joan. They held their nose when she passed by and doused her with cologne. When Joan was 10, she went to church. She wandered in one day. The preacher had a kindly face when he chanted, "Let us pray." He shook her hand and pinched her cheek, said, "How are you, my dear? Why don't you come to Sunday school? I'm sure you'll like it there." In Sunday school, she heard about frail Jesus on a tree and Joseph's coat and Peter's cross and immortality. But when the Christmas concert came, the Easter pageant too, the teacher said, "I'm sorry, Joan, I have no part for you." In school, Joan failed another year. The teacher shook his head. Her mother said, "You stupid slut," and beat her till she bled. The boys still followed her, but now to kiss and hug and squeeze. And when they wanted something more, Joan tried so hard to please. She wore her sweater very tight and shortened up her skirt and put her mother's makeup on and smiled until it hurt. She left the school and went to work in a factory packing fish. Men looked and nudged and looked again and said, "She's quite a dish." But when a sailor came along and stole her heart away, her mother made him marry Joan one rainy August day. When Joan was only 17, she had a baby girl. Her eyes were blue, her cheeks were soft. Her daddy named her Pearl. When Pearl was 4, her mother pushed her down the cellar stairs. When Pearl was 6, her father left, as he planned to do for years. Thank you.
Thanks, Regina. That was so well done. Whoops, going by the mic. Yes, so I know some of you may have to leave, and we totally understand that, so don't feel you're kept in here. But also, if there are other people who want to have something to say, Danette, so whatever suits your purpose.
Thank you, Kathy. This won't take very long. I met Helen in the mid-90s when I was taking my first creative writing course. "You have a flair for writing," she wrote on one of my first assignments. I somehow knew then and there this woman had just become a very important part of my life. I eventually resigned my full-time job and I started a gig as a freelance writer for the Telegram, the Herald, wherever else I could get published. Helen was there every step of the way, encouraging me just about every day. And when I look back on my writing, a lot of the features that I wrote were about people who Helen suggested to me and people who probably otherwise would not have had a voice. And, you know, that makes me feel really good about how she influenced me. And, you know, although it was freelance writing, it was something that I did that I couldn't be happier for doing it. I didn't write because I wanted to. I wrote because I needed to. I'm sure many in the room will understand, but some of my family just couldn't understand that, you know, leaving a job to go freelance for writing. I didn't have a degree. I didn't have anything. But I did it by the seat of my pants for a couple of decades and because of Helen. This is not about me, though. It's about the woman I have admired from the first time she stood in front of our class and spoke to her young upstarts. Her passion for writing was as obvious as the lovely hat that framed her soft face. My only regret is that I lost touch with Helen in later years, when I too became a senior.
but I will never lose the life lessons that she left me with and left so many others with. And it's something like Bernice said as well. She'd always say, look for the good in people, even if you had to search deep to find it. And sometimes we laughed about how deep we really had to search. To me, Helen's writing is passionate yet powerful, clever yet candid, simple yet strong, just like the woman we are here tonight to celebrate. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Hi. I'm not going to talk about Helen's writing or her career as such, but my family grew up with Helen coming to our house on a regular basis because my mom and Helen were very good friends. And they played cards, so it was Helen and John, and Derek is also here, and his mom and dad played cards with them, with a bunch of other people as well. Yes, so Helen's best friend was Ramona, and that's Derek's mom. Oh, Tansley. Sorry, and this is Phoebe Osmond, sorry. So Phoebe and Ramona and, or Moe we called her, and Helen were very good friends, and my mom is not a public speaker, so I just decided I would share on our behalf, and so now I'm getting emotional. So she's meant a lot to our family. I know I can remember them, and I can remember, I'm not too old to remember, or too young to remember John as well, and they were a very nice couple, and I've got to say that one of the things I remember about, I visited Helen where she was in the last few years, and my daughter is also a reader, and she was writing in high school, and Helen always encouraged me to encourage her. We lived in Ottawa, so I didn't see Helen a lot in the last 20 years, but my first 20 or 25 years, I saw her monthly or biweekly or whatever that was. She was at our house, and at one point, my daughter wrote a story, and she won an award for it, and Helen wanted to see it, and I brought it to her and asked her if she could just give it a once-over and give us some advice, and she was very happy to do that, and when I went in, she had it marked and gave us a couple of things, and I was so happy that she did that, and I really appreciated it. But we appreciated Helen, and my mom used to go see her at the home, and she loved to visit there, and I just wanted to say how much she enjoyed last night and the family, and she is really going to miss her. So, thanks.
Thank you, Mercy. Okay, anybody else want to say anything at all? Going once.
We have a hand over here.
A hand over here.
My name is Colleen. I'm probably the only one on Uncle John's side of the family here right now because all of our cousins live away. But of the Salvation Army family, I'm the Catholic. and Aunt Helen and Uncle John, that they didn't even see Catholic. They just loved me for who I was, and that was it. As a matter of fact, when they came to my wedding at St. Teresa's Church, Uncle John made sure he wore his Salvation Army uniform. So, and I'm sure Aunt Helen was behind that as well. Just want to say that loved her very much, and will miss her a lot. Thank you.
Okay, anybody else want to speak before we kind of conclude the formal part? I see a hand going up, I think.
I'd like to say a few words about how encouraging Helen was to young people who were trying to write, and I was one of those years ago, and she was really encouraging, and of course, already being an established writer herself, that was appreciated a lot. A lot of writers don't bother to help other people, but Helen was entirely different. I'm sure I wasn't the only one she helped. So it's just a part of her generosity. Thank you.
Thank you, Marilyn. Okay, well, I want to thank everybody for coming tonight. I really, really, really appreciate it. The family is just so heartfelt that you took the time to come out and share this with us and share with Mom. And couldn't have gotten any better for us, and I'm sure she's looking down up or up on us or whatever. She's here. There's no question about that. You know.
Don't worry, we're not going to sing. We just need a shot for the video, but we also, as Steve said, I can't even express how wonderful it's been tonight. Given how many months it was since the funeral, or since Mom died, planning this, you know, you just wonder what the response will be. We knew people loved and admired Mom, but this is just beyond my expectations, the warmth and people making the effort to come out like this. So I just want to thank everybody, and the musicians were absolutely fantastic. The speakers, the readers, my great niece Evangeline, who had to change her poem at the very last moment because somebody else read it, and she came up and read like a professional, and Robert Burgess for being such a great MC. And our technical guys were fantastic. And I'm sure I've left out others. And Lynn for coming so far to be such a great Fogwell presence. And there are other choir Fogwells, which is unusual, tonight in the audience.
Oh, we're looking at you.
And did you have anything else you wanted to add? Okay.
Just thank you to the Bella Vista staff, the Bella Vista Courtney.
Okay, good night, everybody, and God bless.